Well, you have already studied marketing management before you start the course, so I believe you must have a fair idea of what a marketing is. So in case you know, no one wants to volunteer, what I'll do is we'll start with this a short presentation of the marketing management itself, just a couple of slides, and then we'll go to the services marketing. Fine. So marketing in short means that, just hold on, I'm not able to, yeah. Okay. Marketing in short means you are able to identify, anticipate, and supply the customer requirements efficiently and profitably. So there are three things which are important over here: identification, anticipation, and finally delivery. So I believe by now you're already aware what the difference between marketing and selling is. There is definitely a lot of difference. If you see very closely, as we'll talk about in for the last few question related to selling as we go on further. But at the moment, let's talk about this marketing management. So first of all, you have to find what the customer actually wants. Then you have to think how you can provide a solution. And finally, deliver it. And whatever you provide has to be efficient and profitable. Means it has to be efficient in the sense you're going to making the minimum resources, and thereby it's profitable to the company, because you may provide a very good deal to the consumer, but ultimately if your company is not making profit, then it is not very a successful marketing strategy. So as Kotler says, good marketing is not an accident but a result of careful planning and execution. In short, can we say very easily that marketing needs profitably? That marketing actually meets it meets the needs of the customers profitably. That's the shortest and sweetest definition of a marketing you can ever have. The goal of a marketing management is to meet the needs of the customer profitably. Okay. Okay, so difference in between marketing and selling, it's very commonly, you know, generally in India, it's very commonly you have jobs which many of you are working, most of you are working, I believe. And, you know, they give you a designation of marketing manager, marketing officer, marketing executive, but in turn actually turns out to be actually a sales job. So there is a lot of difference, and we'll cover some of the points over here. One is the selling is internally focused. And marketing is externally focused. When you say internally, it means you're internally focusing on your company, on your product, on your benefit. When I say externally focused for marketing, what I mean to say is marketing is more focused towards the customer. So when you say it's focused towards the customer, you consider his needs and desires, his options, whatever he has, the pricing you put according to what he can pay, rather than in selling with a pricing is based on your profitability, right? So these are some of the things, like in selling it focuses on product, in marketing focuses on customer wants, the needs in the selling it is more focused towards on your needs, then in the marketing more towards the needs of the buyers. In selling, generally, what you do is you first make a product and then develop a selling strategy later on. Whereas in the marketing, you first determine what he wants and then make an appropriate product. So here's the difference. You're basing it, your entire strategy on first deciding what the customer wants. So definitely selling is sales volume oriented, and in marketing, it is profit oriented. It's short term again selling, and in long term, in marketing. So can anyone tell when you receive a call from a credit card guys, are they marketing their product or they're selling the product? Anyone? Hello? No one? Fine. It's more probably. Yes, that's right. Ravi Kiran, fine. You can, you know, whenever I ask someone and someone wants to speak, he can switch on his mic. So that will be audible to everyone. That's not a problem with me. Thanks, Ravi. So we move on now. introduction to services, the difference between physical goods and services. I think this belief is also, you know, thing you have covered. Some of the things, the difference, it's tangible. Goods are tangible, means you can see, you can feel, you can, there's a dimension which can be felt about. There is a, you know, weight attached to it, wherein services, it is intangible. It is not a physical thing. Because it is tangible, so definitely the physical goods are homogeneous in nature. So, and in services, heterogeneous. So when we say by homogeneous, what I mean to say is that when you buy a laptop, for example, a laptop of a Lenovo laptop of a particular type, or let's take this Red Mi 4 phone. Every Red Mi phone will have the same weight. Every Red Mi phone, Red Mi 4A, whatever that model is, same model will have same RAM, is expected to have the same performance, right? And that is the reason when there is a difference in performance or different in the dimensions or any other thing, you go to the service center for a complaint because you are expected to have the same thing. Whereas in services, it's heterogeneous. Even though two friends go to the same restaurant for the same food, let's take, for example, you had a lunch now, Malai Kofta. Although you're eating in the same restaurant, paying the same amount at the same time, right, it is quite possible that the cook who has made it or the service which has delivered the food to you, it will not always be 100% safe. You know, a waiter can take more time for delivery. A cook can take more time. They might be a little bit different in spices. They could be like, you know, the way waiter approaches you. All these things can be considered. It could be more hot in your plate and will be less on the other. So therefore, it's heterogeneous. That's the key thing about services. It is always heterogeneous. It's never homogeneous. And because in physical goods, the production and consumption happens at the same, from a different place than where it is consumed. A laptop is made, generally all the electronics are made in Taiwan and you get delivered here in India or anywhere in the world. In services, it happens at the same time. You go to a restaurant, it is being cooked, it is being served, and it is being delivered and consumed by you at the same place. Until unless you are taking it at home, which is a slightly variation. Or taking a different example, if you go to a barber shop, then the barber is cutting your hair and your hair is being cut at the same time. So that is what I mean by simultaneous production and consumption. So he's cutting your hair and at the same time your hair is being cut. Okay. Physical goods are thing, services are generally an activity or process, right? So core value processed in factory, core value produced in the buyer-seller interaction. Customers in physical goods do not participate in the production process. Here customers participate in the production. Many times they participate. How do they participate in the production? Simply because the services are customizable. So when you go to a restaurant, you tell them you want basically a Malai Kofta, coming to that, with less salt or maybe with more spicy. You can do that variation and accordingly he'll produce it. So that's called participation in production. Same as if you go to a barber shop, you tell him this is the type of hairstyle you like. And this is the type you want, medium, big or small hair to be kept. So accordingly, he'll do that. He'll also use the tools. When we go to barber, many times he say, don't use this razor. So that use this or use that. That means we are helping in the production. Of course, since physical good is tangible and homogeneous, tangible, it can be stocked. Services cannot be stocked. Once your hair is cut, that's it. It's done. If you want to have it, the haircut again, the service again of a barber again, you have to get it again. You can't keep that thing with you. You can't keep the service. You may keep the byproduct of it, like the leftover hair, but actually you cannot keep it. So because it is tangible, the physical good, there is a transfer of ownership possible. It can be sold. You sell one laptop to another. But because services, the consumption and production happens at the same time, at the same place, there is no second-hand market for it. Okay, so generally describing the sectors of economy, how an economy generally is, you know, operates. On they operate generally on the three levels: the primary sector, the secondary sector, and the tertiary sector. In the primary sector, if you see, generally it's the basic production which generally happens is agriculture, forestry, mining, fishery, all these things, right? And in the secondary, you have production of goods, means you are taking those initial primary production output. In agriculture, you have the rice or whatever it is, right? In the secondary sector, the same thing, from rice you may start making into a canned rice, or maybe into a pulav, and then canning it and then selling it. So that's a secondary sector. In the tertiary sector, you have the services, so education, culture, you know, banks, transport, health, hospitality, all these things come into this. So even the course what you're doing currently is part of the tertiary sector. So services come into the tertiary sector. And as the economy of any nation advances in terms of higher per capita income over a period of time, the share of the services sector in the economy increases. So if you go to the African countries, many of the least developed African countries or the poorer countries in the world, there majority of the share of GDP comes from primary sector, some up to 75-80-85% also. But if you go to the United States, most advanced economies, 80-85%, even 90% of the advanced economies GDP comes from the services sector. So India also, you can see the chart over a period of time, has improved from the in the 1950s to a majority in agrarian economy with the primary sector based economy to a tertiary sector. It's growing currently. So this is India's GDP, and you can see how the different areas are being different sectors, they're contributing to the GDP. Agriculture in 2013-14 was 18%, services 15%, financial 18%. So we have to combine various services, trade, this and this. Trade, transport, financial services, they have to be combined together. They are all part of the services industry. And the latest data is this: India is 11th in the services output in the entire world. The services sector provide employment to 28.6%. This is 2014 data, whatever I could get is there. India's GDP as of 2017 is $2.45 trillion, right? Now, this is a nominal one. I hope you must have undergone classes where you know the difference between nominal and PPP, right? So in the PPP, rating is $9.5 trillion. Now, share of services in India's GDP is 53.8% in 2016. So more than half of India's economy, you know, the GDP share comes from services. So as we are seeing the services becoming more and more, giving more and more contribution to the Indian economy, and it is growing, and it is growing in sector. So which is a sign of our advancement. Okay, so services could meet. So considering this, regarding the services sector, that is the reason why the course on services sector, services marketing has come in, because promoting services is, although uses the same fundamentals as promoting goods, physical goods, but it is slightly distinct. It is not totally unique, but it is distinct from it. So the way you deliver it, the way you try to look at things are different from there. The fundamentals remain the same of marketing, but they are presented very differently because additional things come into the picture when services marketing is taken into consideration. And that's why we study, because services sector, most of the people today, you know, especially the high paying jobs exist in the services sector. So you should know about the services sector and how the strategies over there work is for your benefit only. So services could meet personal needs like haircuts, tuition, legal, business needs, courier services, office cleaning services, fresh flowers and all these things are some of the examples. So, you know, what is service marketing? Services are separately identifiable activities that satisfy customer needs or wants through essentially intangible benefits, either in their own right or as a significant element of a tangible product. So if you see this definition, which is given over there very closely, you will see that it gives an it does an activity which satisfies customer needs and it gives them intangible benefits. For example, there's a tangible benefit for you to own a laptop. You have a laptop, you have a physical laptop of this weight, you can, you know, you can see it, you can touch it, you can use it, check its performance, you can check the RAM and check the hard disk and all these things, right? And even the battery backup. But in services, many of the things, the performance will be in the form of intangible one. Whether the food was good or bad depends upon your perception. Because if the same malai kofta, what we talked about earlier, was given to your friend who is sitting on the next table at the same day, at the same time, served by the same waiter, cooked by the same cook, still he may perceive it as a bad malai kofta, right? At the same restaurant. So how is that happened? Because it is very intangible. You know, it is based not on hardcore facts. It is based on more on perceptions. And that perception is based on various factors. We'll talk about it later. That comes about it. So it's intangible benefits. And intangible benefits are very hard to define and not very easy to fulfill. And intangible benefits also varies from person to person. Right? Now, either the services can be on your own, like, you know, you have this e-commerce site where they're fully services, where you're buying your products online, right? You can buy it online and you can get it delivered there. Or even a better example is you're downloading a antivirus solution from a website. So the entire thing is served through services. There's no physical component to it. But most of the products come with services section. So if the services section part of a product of a entire product is much more than the physical good, then it comes into the services sector, services part. And that's the reason why a restaurant comes, a hospitality industry comes in the services sector, because you do not go there to eat food. You have not gone there to eat food. You have gone to a restaurant to get everything. Not only a nice food, but the entire ambience, what you don't get at home, right? The ability to make a type of food, to get it ordered the way you want, which probably is not possible at home. That's why it comes under the service sector. Although the physical good as a food itself is important. Same as in a hotel. You know, you don't go there just to sleep. If you had gone to a hotel just to spend your night, then there would be no competition, because the five stars are charging for the same bed more than the one-star hotel or three-star hotel or even four-star hotel, just by having additional services added to the same room or the other ambiences. Okay, so yeah, so that's the services. Now moving on. So you have defining and improving quality. What are the this thing for services? Challenges for services. Okay, defining and improving quality, that's for sure. You know, it's many times it's not possible to define the quality and forget about improving it. Then communicating and testing new services. How do you communicate the services to the customers? The entire thing of communicating the benefits a customer get, because in a product you can actually show the product to the customer, that this is a product, this is how it looks, this and that. But for services, it requires an experience. You can't keep on giving haircut to people on the street by telling that this that's not the only way to demonstrate that this is a good arbor, this is a good barber, right? There has to be a different way of communicating. So we'll talk about it when we discuss about the different piece of services, right? Communicating and maintaining a consistent image. An image is important because services generally are heterogeneous in nature. Even though you're communicating our product is good, that consistency has to be maintained and that image has to be maintained consistently. Think of a burger. A burger of McDonald's around the world is of the same size, more or less tastes same, and they ensure it through their supply chain. The McDonald's will ensure it that the burger what a customer in India gets in Chennai or in Dubai is more or less tastes same, has the same ingredients and weighs same. And if they make some changes, they launch a new type of burger over there, but not the same one. So that's the whole idea of maintaining a consistent image. Even though there is heterogeneous, but yet you want to maintain a consistent image with the customer. Motivating and sustaining employee commitment, because services involve a lot of heterogeneity and it involves a lot of people participation. So therefore, employee motivation has to be very, very strong, and therefore you need to constantly motivate your employees so that they remain committed to the customer satisfaction. You require coordinating operations, marketing and human resource efforts. Definitely you need to, if you are not hiring the right people, then you won't be able to do good marketing. And of course you have to tie up with the supply chain people also to ensure that whatever product or service, whatever the services you want to deliver to the customer, they are at the optimum type. You need to set prices. Now, why setting prices is a challenge? Can anyone tell? Anyone, why do you think, setting prices for services is a challenge? Anyone? Ravi Kiran? No one. Okay, fine. I'll. Okay, good. The reason is why setting price of a service is a challenge, because if you go back to the marketing management, there were four P's. I hope you all remember the four P's which were there, right? Product, price, promotion, and place. And in that, one of the if you see that see the study the four P's very naturally, very closely, you will find out, and probably you have been told also, among all the four P's, the price factor, the price, the P for price, is the easiest to deal with. Why? Because you don't need to design a product, you don't need to start the promotion, you don't need to go to a place and do it. You can just give a number to it. It's 50 rupees, you can do it 55 within a second. But way for other P's, you have to struggle with it. In services, the first thing is the P itself is so easy to set. But unfortunately, because many of the intangible benefits cannot be ascertained for the customers, right? So it may be possible that you have not ascertained their needs very closely. So accordingly, setting prices become difficult. And many times services, generally they try to give freebies. That means they start to give free services so that they know up to how much customers can pay. A good example for it is the Reliance Jio network, which was started by giving free prices. Now, the problem was, although they had huge pockets, they could do it, but the competitors could not. So the competitors were struggling to retain the customers, their subscribers, the Vodafone or Airtel and Idea and others. They were struggling because the Reliance had put a price which no one could compete with. It's absolute zero. And who wouldn't like to go to a situation whereby he's given so many benefits at zero prices? So they never knew that on what basis, at what price customer will come to him, because even at 1 rupee, if they would charge, it is still expensive. So when the Reliance started, Jio started charging money, they were definitely relieved, because at least now they have a price point at which they can compete. So having a price point in mind is very important based on the services you are able to deliver. Other challenge for services is that do you give a standardized service or you give a personalized service, right? So that depends upon the type of services you have. That depends upon what you want to deliver. At certain places, certain times, you want to give only a standardized service where much customization, personalization is not possible. Let's take the example of exchange rates, international money exchange rates. They are very much standardized. Not that just because you want more, you want a better price, they will give you a different price, right? It's more or less standardized. But if you look at the food industry, in the hospitality industry, personalization is a lot possible when you go to a restaurant. I gave you the example of Malai Kofta, how you can, you know, keep on making, asking him to make changes X, Y, Z. And, you know, you want with more salt, less salt, more spicy, you know, all these things. So that is possible. So it allows the variation. Whereas in products, only standardization works. Okay. Other challenges? Giving a feel for the product. So again, coming to the point, how do you demonstrate the benefits of a service you're offering to a customer without actually giving the service to him? It's a very tough situation. You can't give a free sample. You see, I can show my laptop. If I'm selling a laptop, I'm a retailer, I can open the laptop, demonstrate it to the customer. He can check it. He can see the feel of the laptop, see everything, right, and be satisfied. Whereas in a service industry, it's very difficult. So, you know, coming to the restaurant example, how can you tell to the customer in a locality that this is the best restaurant in the town, or to anyone else, where you can't, you at best you can have a photo of your, you know, product, but you don't go there to a restaurant to see a photo of Malai Kofta or palak paneer or whatever it is. You go there to eat the taste and other ambience. So many, you know, that giving a feel of the product is difficult, and many companies do using different strategies. We'll talk about it later, how companies are using it, by giving various examples. So managing demand fluctuations, of course, demand keeps on changing. So, you know, because services very easily, it's may not, many things may not be essential. So demand can fluctuate accordingly. That's a challenge. Cost containment, again, the cost of a product can be very easily be determined by the raw materials to be used. But in services, the cost of the services many times may be inflated or may have to be bring down less the cost of the actual production. So that is there. At what level you should stop charging the customers. Attitudinal block in using proven marketing principles in service marketing. So what you have is many times customers have a block in their mind, which becomes difficult in terms of attitude to market the product. So a good example is, like, you know, the very fact that BSNL and MTNL are government service providers, right? But most people, if given a chance, they don't trust them because they have an attitude block that whatever the government product or service is there, it will not be up to mark. We tend to believe that the government services will not be good. And that's why when the private insurance industry came, there's so many different customers, especially the educated ones, jumped on that. So price, they're ready to pay an extra premium for it, but they want to get that service. So that basic block, it becomes difficult. So some examples of service industry. Right, so if you see all these things, all these examples, they are very much as part of our daily life, and we tend to use them at some point or the other in our life. So as you can see, the services are very common in our day-to-day industry, day-to-day life, and we keep on bumping into them and using them. So as I'm telling you about the that there are very few things which are pure services and very few things which are pure goods. So there is a good service continuum. Now, if you see over there on the left-hand corner, there's a canned food, mostly goods. On the other side is the mostly services, insurance, consulting, teaching, right? So what you have in between, when I say continuum, it means it's like a line. It's a continuous line, and restaurant meals are coming somewhere in the middle. The reason it is considered part of service industry, because the reason for the, why do you go to a restaurant? You go to a restaurant for having a different aspects along with the meal. Physical food is just one aspect. It's the taste, the ambience of the restaurant, the way it is charged, the way the whether it is paper napkin or cloth napkin, whether it's the pipe music, right? All these things, whether you stand up and eat, whether you it's takeaway. So it's a service. Therefore, you go there for these various reasons. And that's the reason why, you know, you can go to Haldiram, and if you go to nearby roads, road in India, it's very common that, you know, you can eat at least in Delhi for 15, 20 rupees a plate of chole bhature on this, on a push cart, on a cart which is on the roadside. But if the same chole bhature go to Haldiram, it is not cost less than 70 rupees. Why do you pay 70 rupees for it? Of course, beyond a certain point, definitely there's an improvement in ingredient. That's one point. But you pay for the other factors, air-conditioned place, you get in disposable plates, you know, you have disposable napkins. It's made in much more cleaner environment. So all these things. So therefore, if you see it, most of the, you know, products in the world today, they are a mix of both, and they are a mix of both. So therefore, it is on a goods and services continuum. And when the service component of any product increases more than 50%, then therefore it comes into the service industry. Okay, the scope of services, what are the different scope of services? It can be for profit. It may not be for profit. NGOs, right? The world's largest bank for the poor is Grameen Bank of Bangladesh. It provides low-cost financial services to the poor in Bangladesh. And of course, it is the largest bank probably in the Bangladesh as well. So, you know, so difference between goods and services, many things we have covered: intangibility, heterogeneity, production, consumption, same time, perishability. We'll see about this, what are the implications of each characteristic. So intangibility: customer is unable to experience the product prior to purchase because it's intangible. So what are the implications of intangibility? Means how does it impact you? Services cannot be inventoried. There is no inventory for services. Services cannot be patented. Very difficult. Services cannot be readily displayed or communicated. I cannot show. So many restaurants are trying to make a sample of their product and keep it in the shelf sometimes. This is how it looks. That's a thing. But that's just a part that they're showing only the food component. Right, so it's difficult. So many times they give, when you go to a festivals and all these things, you'll find some fast food guys giving you free samples of their food items so that you can experience it. That's the idea. They overcome that communication barrier. Pricing is difficult. Then second characteristic, perishability. So perishability, can't be stored. Implications: it is difficult to synchronize supply and demand with services because it is highly perishable. The services finish the time you stop production. The services cease to exist. The barber, as soon as he stops cutting your hair, that's the time he stopped delivering you the service at the same time. Whereas a laptop can be manufactured 5 years earlier and still be sold. So it's not perishable. Services cannot be returned or resold because it's perishable. Then inseparability. Production consumption happens at the same place and cannot be separated. What are the implications? Customers participate in the effect. Participate in and affect the transaction. So I gave you the example how if you want a different type of malai kofta than your friend, you can give him, you can tell him, the waiter, that please instruct the cook that, you know, I want of this flavor in this way. Or probably you can even say bring after half an hour, or bring along with chapati, or bring with the rice. So that differentiation you can have. And accordingly, you're making a difference in production. So customers affect each other. Definitely, you learn from each other by seeing. Employees affect the customer service outcome. Yes, you can. The way if the waiter gives you an idea that maybe this restaurant is famous for spicy type of this dish, so you may not even order that food for which you have gone to the restaurant for it. You may order a different one just because an idea has come from an employee. Or the other way around, that you have ordered the dish and the dish has not been prepared up to your optimum thing, then probably you will not be happy and you may ask for a refund or you may not pay for it. So who is responsible? The cook. The cook can always be held accountable because he has not prepared a good dish for you. So they can affect the service outcome. So an experience for which you have gone to the restaurant for a pleasant experience becomes a bad experience for you. Decentralization may be essential. Yes, many times it is important to ensure all the cogs and wheels work properly. Mass production is difficult. Because there is so much customization, personalization is possible and also required by the customers most of the time, mass production does not become easy in services and therefore remains out of reach. Variability, heterogeneity, difficulty in establishing consistency in quality across providers or within providers, across time, across delivery centers. Yes, you can see how even though you look at the telecom companies. If you go on the website, the first thing they'll ask is, what is your circle? And if you see your circle, many of the plans are based on your circle. And that may not be there in a different circle. Maybe if you're based in Delhi NCR, they have a certain pricing for the same benefits. And if you're in Andhra Pradesh, then you have a different pricing for the same benefits. And also across providers or within providers, suppose you are, you know, they give certain benefits. If you are a person of, you want this much of data, then you get a cheaper rate across deliver centers also. Right. And they change with time. They change with time. So whatever benefits they were providing maybe a year back, they are providing better than that. And you can see how the pricing of the telecom operators have changed after Jio launched a triple benefit scheme just about on 2 days back in November 10. When if you recharge by 459, you get 50 vouchers of eight vouchers of 50 each, plus you get a mobile cashback recharge from MobiWeek and different this thing up to 90%, plus you get 2500 worth of vouchers for different sites on Yatra and all, as Yatra and Jio and other things. So as soon as this was launched, the next day Airtel launched a different another offer to compete with that. Now just imagine a person who has taken an Airtel scheme just 5 days earlier, he would be crying because he says, had I waited for 5 days later, I would have got a better deal. But this is what happens. You know, the across time, things will be different because of that, the quality may also differ. So implications, service delivery and customer satisfaction depend on employee actions. So therefore, you know, when you many times you call the call center and with some employees you are satisfied and with others you are not. Service quality depends on many uncontrollable factors. Yes, it is. So as you can see now, on what are the uncontrollable factors in the telecom industry now is the competition from Jio, because that was not thought of and it is beyond their control. They can control their expenses, they can control their customers, but they cannot control the pricing given by Jio and the type of benefits they are giving. So that becomes uncontrollable. This is one example. Other is the government policies. So there is no sure knowledge that service delivered matches what was planned and promoted. This is the problem in services. You had a particular type of quality, right? And which was planned by the company. and was trained to the employees that this is what needs to be delivered, or it was promoted on the television ads, in newspaper ads, but unfortunately that was not delivered in the way it was expected to be. So it becomes difficult in that case, because of heterogeneity, to maintain that thing, to maintain the, you know, that heterogeneity variation. Because even if you're talking to a call center employee, for example, yes, a same person who's talking in a particular tone, one person will find him to be rude, other person will find him to be pleasant. So because of that, same haircut, one person finds that haircut to be lousy, other one finds he's looking like a hero. So these are the examples. Same dish, one person finds to be tasty in a restaurant, other one person finds it to be obnoxious, right? So you find these, all these examples. So services are different. So same thing what we discussed about, we talked about earlier, is given in one slide. So you can go through it later on. So what are the reasons for growth in services sector, right? First of all is growth in intermediate demand from firm. So when we say intermediate, there are three types of demand, right? There's a raw demand, there's an intermediate, and there's a final demand. Intermediate means one company is providing services not to the final end consumer, but is providing to the firm which actually provides services to the final consumer. So an intermediate demand, let's take an example, the demand of hard disks will increase if the demand of laptops increase or desktop increases. So here the hard disk is an intermediate demand which is dependent upon the demand of the laptops or desktops. The demand of tires will increase if the car sales increase. So the demand, because tire is a byproduct, it's a part and parcel of the final product, which is the car. Same is that hard disk is a product, is a part and parcel of the finished product, which is desktop or laptop. So it's an intermediate demand. So when that intermediate demand is increasing in services sector, right? So that is one thing. It is increasing. So we can give an example, is telecom industry. Telecom industry is in the business of giving you call services. It is in the business of giving you data services. But at the same time, along with this, they also have a call center whereby you can call them up and clear your queries. So most of the companies do not have their own call centers. They have outsourced that service to another company which specializes in operating call centers, like IBM Daksh, like WNS, right? So they have a different call centers where they approach different companies which run the call, their call centers on their behalf. So these companies, telecom industry is rising, and therefore these other companies are also rising because of them. Then growth in final demand from customers, increase in affluence. Why there's a growth of final demand from customers? Customers are people in general are becoming more richer. People have more leisure time these days, means they have less. If you see, most of the economy is automated, so people don't have to work hard so much, so they have more time for their other activities. Most of the women have their more share of women working these days than maybe our parents or grandparents. Growth in population of dinks. What do you mean by dinks? Can anyone tell me? Vasanti, who is Vasanti? His mic is on. Vasanti, tell me who is dinks. What is dinks? Vasanti, are you there?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, tell me what is dinks. Tell us what is dinks. Everyone wants to hear. What is dinks?
Dinks means?
Yes, what does it mean?
It's a soft drink, sir.
No, this is not drinks. It is dinks. Dinks stands for double income, no kids.
Okay, sir. Sorry,
Yeah,
sir.
okay. So it doesn't matter. DINKS, this DINKS stands for double income, no kids. D is double, I or income, N is no, K is kids, right? KS. So it means double income, no kids couples. There are couples who are husband and wife, both are working, but they don't have any kids. So that is the growth of population. Many people are delaying their marriages. Many people are getting married, but they are not having children early. So that size of population is increasing because those people are both of husband and wife, both are working, and because both of them are working. So therefore, what is happening is they have less, the woman has less time in the kitchen, and so they have more leisure time and less time for the many things what they used to do earlier. So accordingly, the growth of, you know, the demand of services has come from such customers also. Greater life expectancy, people are living more. Greater complexity of products. Products are becoming more difficult to use. You'll understand. You know, took a look at the earlier phone. All we knew is we had to just dial, pick up the phone and dial. Today, a smartphone is so difficult. You know, you have to look for XYZ, where the settings are and all these things. And yet many times it fails, right? So products have become very complex to operate. So therefore, you require services. In service in the form of manuals, services in the form of, you know, call centers where they help you with all these things. Then life has become more complex. Of course, there's a resource scarcity. Oil is, let's take an example, oil is becoming more and more scarce. There's a concern for ecology. People are worried about environment and other things. Then there's an increasing number of new products which are coming up in the market. Okay. Then reasons for growth of services in India. What are the reasons? In India specifically, that was for in general. This is for India. Economic influence, affluence, same. Changing role of women, because women are working more and they've got more rights. So that is one example. Cultural changes. IT revolution has been very strong because of IT. Most of the many of the services are automated and happen through the IT industry. Right? Development of markets. Unbundling corporations. Corporations are, what is happening is corporations are demerging. It means small corporations are coming up, and therefore many of the things which large corporation used to own, now they are outsourcing their thing, like a telecom center, they are outsourcing the call center, right? Courier services, they are being outsourced. So it's an age of specialization. Increasing consciousness of healthcare, people are becoming health conscious. Economic liberalization has been very strong point in that. Migration of people from one city to another, from small town to, you know, cities, from villages to cities, and from India and abroad and vice versa. Export potential, right? I can very easily export services. I can sit in India, make a software, sell it to a person in America, get the payment online. So easy. But to do an export of a physical product like a laptop, it will be a long process. I have to go through so many channels of government accreditation, and it is very difficult to serve them. So you see that, you know, many people in Andhra Pradesh and all, I had my friends over there. They have started their website services sector, where what they do is they make websites for offshore clients from abroad. So they are able to do it very easily because through a website, I am able to promote my company or my services to the entire world 365 days a year, 24/7, which is not possible in a physical product, which is not possible using, you know, pamphlet or banner or whatever it is. And service tax is also there. So factors which are stimulating the transformation of the service economy. Government policies. Yes, government is making services more export oriented. Government is giving more benefits, is giving tax rebates to the services. Like you have the export oriented zones all over India, many places, right? Software export zones. So these are government policies. Change in regulation, privatization, consumer protection, right? Environmental protection, agreements on trade and services. Can anyone tell me which is the international agreement for trade? Anyone? What is the name of the agency world over? What is the name of the agency world over which takes care of the international trade? India is also part of that. What is the name of the agency internationally? It's WTO, World Trade Organization. That's the agency world over which mandates how the trade should be done. If you are part and parcel of the WTO. So India is a part of it. Then social changes, as we discussed, consumer expectation, more affluence, more people, short of time. Now, this is the problem. People have a lot of money these days, but because they are busy with their lives, they are short of time. People don't have time. And that is the real logic why people tend to go more online and buy products. Because they think at the comfort of my home, at a time and place of my choosing, I can order a product. I need not physically go to the local Kirana store. I need not go to the nearest mall in my home just to get a product. So therefore, what is happening is by ordering it online, I'm saving time. And that's why people are more hooked on to the e-commerce sites. Increased desire for buying experience versus things. People, and of course, the same thing. Why do you go to a mall for a small thing, for one bar of cake? You don't go to a mall to buy that, to buy soap or clothes. You go to mall to get that experience. When you go to a normal shop, normal store, for every product you want, you have to ask that shopkeeper, please show me this, please show me that. You're standing outside in the heat, in the sun, getting all the dust from the road, maybe. If it's covered, it's fine, right? It's not air conditioned. And then at the end of it, he'll ask you money, you'll pay him and get the products to you. Most probably you'll not get a receipt. In a mall, no one asks you what you want. You have a free to look at all the products what you want. You can check all the products at your own time. Here, if you stand outside the shop and if you're asking 10 things of the 10 different soaps, and after some time the shopkeeper will say, decide whether you want to buy or not. Don't waste your time. Where in the mall, you can take your own time for decision making, what type of product you want. You can spend your whole time. Then you have all the products divided, kept on the shelves, and according to different areas, they are kept. They are segregated as per the product type. They are segregated. All biscuits on one side, all chips on one side, all clothes on one side. So you know what you're looking at. You can check. You can go. There is a changing room. You can change your shirt. You can see how it feels on you, right? You have all these benefits. Vasanti, can you switch off your mic, because I'm able to hear your background noise. Okay, so do all these things. So it's an experience. You do that, you get that in the mall. Then there's a air conditioned, there's a piped music, which is music which is flowing over there on your overhead to keep you entertained. And no one, and their people will only, the mall people will only come to you when you have a problem. Or they may ask you, may I help you? Then they'll try to give you all these things. So it's an experience what you get in the mall, which you don't get in a normal shop. And that's what people want these days. They are not going there just to buy things. They are going to a mall to get that experience, or the entire experience of buying also, you know. The entire thing where you go there, purchase, and you are given an option whether you can pay by card or Sodexo passes or by, Paytm or by cash. And at the end of it, you get a receipt. All these things, all the benefits, right? Also, in many places, malls, you have the kids playing area. So the moms don't have to worry about the kids are playing. So that's an experience you get, which you will not get in normal shops. Okay. Then rising consumer ownership of computer sales. Yeah, that's there. More people are owning computers, cell phones, and gadgets. So these equipments, and because we talked about how IT industry is shaping that, so this makes it easy. Easier access to more, because of these gadgets, is easy to know, your consumer is much more aware. Immigration of people from small towns, from small localities to big metros, right, different places, and abroad also. So people, once they travel a lot, they get a lot of ideas from different places. Growing but aging population. Yes, the population generally is aging, not in India, but all over the world. Business trends. So there's a push to increase shareholders' value, because shareholders' value will increase once you the products are sold more, when the company makes more profit. So there's an idea, you know, if I increase the value towards the shareholder, probably more people will buy it. There'll be more people who will basically be interested in the products. Emphasis on productivity and cost saving. Yes, companies want more profitability. Manufacturers add value through service and sell centers. Yes, this is what I'm saying. So it's not just the product. So you look at the laptop, giving an example of a laptop. The laptop, many of the laptops, most of the laptops are made in Taiwan or China, and they are generally more or less of the same configuration. But how do you decide? You decide on the services. Quite often you decide on the services offered by the laptop company. So many, most of them, they are offering 1 year warranty. Some companies offer 2 years. Some companies offer 3 years extended warranty. So you go for that. Some says take a free 1 year license of Windows along with it. Take a free 1 year, free antivirus, a mouse and other things along with it when you buy, right? All these things. Some Asus is a company which is offering up to 5 years of laptop warranty. And warranty up to 5 years on their business models. So through services, they are differentiating themselves and they're adding value to their products. So when the customers are going to buy a product, he looks at the different options and he's able to decide accordingly which one he wants to take. Okay. More strategic alliances and outsourcing. Focus on quality and customer satisfaction. Right. I want customer to be more satisfied. Not the company profitability, but customer satisfaction is the keyword. So profitability will come easily if customer is satisfied. Growth of franchising. If you see in the service industry, it's very common. Today, not every company wants to invest everything everywhere they want to invest, open an office. So many times they tend to give franchisees or licenses to other companies to do it. So when the franchisee opening has come, option has come. So with that, services industry has grown. And if you see in India, McDonald's India is operating through a local Indian company. And even that is divided among 2-3 players. One franchisee in Bombay is having 5-6 shops. And you can see the owner of that McDonald's shop. When you go outside the gate of the McDonald's, you'll see the real owner. The real owner, although they are using the brand name of McDonald's from the McDonald's America, but actually the shop, the so-called restaurant of McDonald's at that place, is owned by a particular individual or a company, which probably may not be, most of the time, may not be the original McDonald's in America. So that's a franchising. Marketing emphasis by non-profits. Yeah, even the non-profits these days are marketing their products. Advance in information technology. So there's a growth of internet, right? That's for sure. Greater bandwidth. After Jio, India became the world's, as per Jio, I'm not sure how far it's true, but according to them, that the Jio has the more people are on broadband in India today than anywhere in the world. The average per capita broadband is highest in India, as per Jio, after they came. Mobile became very easy, small, powerful, easy to handle, with long battery lives, right, and cheaper. Wireless networking, faster, more reliable software, digitization of text, graphics, audio, video, that's for sure. You know, your CDs and all, they are not so much of purchase these days. People tend to download the videos and audios and all these things. Globalization. More companies operate on transnational basis. increased international travel, that's for sure. International merger and acquisitions. JVs over here means joint ventures. Offshoring of customer service, as I told you about, most of the call centers are located in India, Philippines, because Indians and those Philippines also, they are able to speak English. So many call centers are over here. And of course, besides English, we are having a cheaper workforce, a cheaper but skilled workforce. Foreign competitors invade domestic markets, yes, for sure. Foreign companies are coming to Indian markets and Indian companies are going abroad and competing. So you have foreign companies selling food items over here, right? And Indian, like Himalaya products, is also sold in America and has an Himalaya America based in Texas state in America, where they're selling it over there. Okay, I just want to ask you, is there a break in between for a few minutes or there's no break? Can anyone tell me? Is break done or not?
No break, sir.
No break. Okay, take it. You want break? 2 minutes?
Yes, yeah, sir.
Okay, I'll give you 2 minutes break, right? We'll come back on two. But be there, huh? 2 minutes I'll come.
Okay, sir.
Okay, is everyone here? Okay, so let's start again. So now we'll talk about different types of services or role of services in economy using different types, right? So you'll find these, you know, many times these questions come, what are different types of services? How are services classified? Each one is a different way to answer it. And we'll talk about it in the next slides also. So this is different types of services or the different roles with services perform in economy. One is value-added services. They add value like financing, leasing, insurance, infrastructure service, communications, transportation, utilities. So you, in utility, it's a water providing electricity. Electricity company is a utility company. Company which provides you water is a utility company. Banking. All these part of the infrastructure service. Manufacturing services include company. Right? Manufacturing services inside company, finance, accounting, legal, R&D and design. Distribution service, wholesaling, retailing, repairing, personal service, health, healthcare, restaurant, hotels, business service, supporting manufacturing, consulting. So these business services, they support manufacturing, like waste disposal. These days, government has a central board of pollution control. They go to factories and check whether whatever you're producing, the byproducts are not disposed of, any harmful thing is not just dumped. It is has to be disposed of properly through their certain government regulations. So whether it's solid waste or water waste or whatever it is. So, and other things like consulting and auditing, the auditors come once a year in the companies to check. So these are the services being provided to manufacturers. Consulting, consultants may be hired to improve their marketing. Consultants may be hired to set up a factory. Consultants may be hired to train their people. So like this, very, of course, advertisers always, you have advertising agencies which specialize in making ads for companies. And government service, military, education, judicial, all these things. Now, that's the type of services in an economy. And next is the service classification. You know how the services are divided based on the service process metrics. So that one is the type of services. And this one is the classification of services based on the service process, the types of processes. So there are two types of, if you look at it, there are four types of services have been put up over here, depending upon two criteria. On one end of the criteria is degree of interaction and customization. On the other end, on the other side is the degree of labor and intensity. And each one has been divided into low and high. So let's take one by one and it will become much more clear what we are talking about. So you look at the first one on the left hand corner, top, service factory. Now service factory example is airlines, trucking, hotels, resorts and recreation. Here the degree of interaction and customization is given low and degree of labor intensity is given low. So if you see it very closely, it's fact that in airline industry, you don't, most of the things is automated. The plane flies, the pilot just controls the airplane. The ticket is generated automatically using website or through a computer, right? So most of the things are automated. So degree of, labor intensity is less. At the same time, the degree of interaction and customization is limited. It's low. So how it's limited? Like if you want to go from Delhi to Mumbai, right? The amount of customization the airline has offered are different types of different slots. You can go in the morning, afternoon or evening at different slots. But you cannot demand, I want to go at 9:30 at my time. Because those slots have already been determined by the airline that 9:30, 10 o'clock in the morning flight, 12:30 afternoon and 5:30 in the evening. But you can't say, I want 9:30. I want customization. No, that is not possible. Same is trucking. Same is hotels. They have certain types of beds. Certain services are provided in different type of rooms, right? Little bit of customization is there, but you can't do beyond certain things. Same is resorts and recreation. So these are examples of this. Then coming down on the just below that, mass services. Retailing, wholesaling, school, retail aspect of commercial banking. Over here, if you see, degree of labor intensity is high. Retailing involves a lot of movement of goods from left, taking from the manufacturer up to their filling center, from filling center to their store, from store warehouse to their, from the centralized warehouse to their warehouse to the shelves, from the shelves when customer takes to packing, and then again refilling and ensuring that whatever goods have removed from there, that that needs to be stocked up. So this is an example how a lot of labor intensity, same is wholesaling. Lot of in wholesale business, lot of goods are moved around very regularly, right? So then in retail aspect, again, commercial banking, retailing, you have to deal with customers regularly, you have to solve the queries, and in the private banks, you also fill up the forms. So a lot of degree of, you know, labor intensity is very high, but interaction and customization is limited. In retailing, wholesaling, again, if you look at it, how much of customization is possible? In school, it's a set standard of syllabus which is given to a person, to a student of a particular class. He has to come and sit. A set uniform is there. He has to wear that. Same is wholesaling. You know, a particular, there can be changes in quantity. There can be changes in price a little bit, but not much. In retailing also, you know, whether you're tall or short, if chips are kept in the tallest aisle, it will be kept over there because that's what they have decided. They have given a particular price for a product. They will not change it. They might give you a discount now and then, right? So that that is there. Now coming to the degree of to the top right hand top corner. In the service shop, you have hospitals, auto repair, other repair services. Here, the degree of labor intensity is low, but the degree of customer interaction and customization is very high. Why? You look at hospitals. When you go to a hospital, what happens? You go there to, you know, get your disease diagnosed and get a solution. So what does a doctor do? Doctor sits with you, talks to you, takes your, you know, temperature, right? Checks your pulse, puts a stethoscope, and asks you to do certain things, lie down there, lie down. He may not do these things with everyone. He may not give the same medicine to everyone. He may not ask the same questions to everyone. So it's extremely customized. It's extremely interactive. This interactiveness and customization is required. Otherwise, you will not be able to diagnose it. He may offer you different tests. Go and get a blood tested for XYZ. But for other one, it could be ABC, right? So that's a customization. Then auto repair. You have a problem with the engine, then the auto guy will try to resolve the engine problem. Not that he'll, for everyone, he'll do the same thing. If you have a paint job to be done in auto shop, he'll do that. If your tire is deflated, he'll try to inflate the tire and rectify the puncture. So like this, all these services are extremely interactive with the customers and a lot of customization, right? The labor intensity is not so high. In the other hand, you have professional services like physicians. Why in auto repair, why the labor intensity is not high? Because most of the things is done generally using tools. In the professional services, you have physicians, lawyers, accountants, architects. So as you see on top, hospitals are given. Hospitals are given which are low labor intensity, but high labor intensity comes in physicians. Physicians means doctors. So doctors do all these things, but in hospital, most of the things are automated, like, you know, X-ray automated, but it's customized depending upon what the doctors advise you to do, right? Blood test customized, right? So, but it is done through machines. It is not much labor intensity is required. Hello, are you? Is everyone able to hear me? Is everyone able to hear me? Okay, good.
Yes, right. Sir.
Yeah, fine, fine. Okay, same as lawyers. If you have a problem with a legal case, the lawyer will listen to your case and try to settle it and find it whether he can solve it. Same as accountants who try to rectify your books, or chartered accountants, or architects who design a house or a building for you on your behalf based on your parameters. So it requires a lot of labor intensity. At the same time, it is highly interactive with the customer and you get customized service. So therefore, you get these four different classifications. So this service process matrix is based on two different criteria, degree of interaction customization and degree of labor intensity, and which itself is divided into two, high and low. So accordingly, you have four different types: service factory, service shop, mass services, and professional services. I hope it's clear to everyone. Okay. So now question is, how do you win customers in service business? Like you know, why some services work and some services do not work? Why some services work and some services do not work? A company offering different type of services, multiple companies offering same types of services, but some companies are successful, other companies are not successful. Let's take the case of e-commerce websites. So many small players came into existence and started launching their online sites where people can buy it, online retail. You have Flipkart, Snapdeal, Paytm, Amazon, and there may be other, I'm not sure, but there are many, right? Right, they, which they are offering, right? Among them, if you see Amazon, Amazon is the largest player as of now. Amazon and Flipkart are the largest player in India, right? Snapdeal is struggling and was about to be closed, but somehow it survived, right? Paytm is also struggling, but Paytm has a lot of, angel investor money. The international investors, they've invested a lot of money, so it is able to sustain itself. Right. So why is that these companies have done well? In Flipkart has done better than Snapdeal. Why Snapdeal has not done? Both are Indian companies, Indian e-commerce company. You can say Amazon is an international e-commerce company, so they have deep pockets to survive. Right. If that is the case, why Flipkart has done better? Both Flipkart and Snapdeal both were funded by international players. Why the Flipkart is doing better than Snapdeal? Snapdeal was almost about to close or about to merge with the Flipkart, but they said no. Snapdeal said, the board of directors said no. Right. The other example, Ola and Uber, right? They are competing with each other. And you go around in different places, like in places like Bombay, Uber is the choice of consumers when they book a taxi. But if you come to Delhi, Ola, generally customers prefer Ola. And this is basically validated by the drivers, who, because most of the drivers, they have both Ola and Uber option. They say the Uber drivers generally do not get so much of jobs as the Ola drivers do. So what are the USPs? USPs, as you are all aware, unique selling propositions. So what USPs service businesses should have to ensure they get more and more, retention, or at they become more attracted to the customers, attractive to the customers. One is availability. How accessible is the service? Right. So ATMs, banking is a service, but banking's brought in ATM because ATM allows us to do a service, take out transaction, do the cash transaction, take out the money, right? 24 hours a day. And if you look at it, many companies have brought beyond ATM, they brought a check depositing service where you can deposit the check. And I've also seen that you can get your passbook printed in certain ATM machines. That facility is there. You put your passbook, especially in the national bank, because these days in the private banks you don't have the passbook concept, but in the national banks like PNB, Punjab National Bank, you have a machine where you put your passbook there, and it reads through laser beam your barcode, and it updates your passbook. So you need not go to the banking official inside. You can do it, and that's 24 hours a day. So availability, convenience, the location of service where customer must travel for that service. So you know, again, I talked about why, if you look at it, the Kirana store is a convenient to you, closest to you, the local shop selling you soap. But the reason you went to the mall, because you wanted an experience of buying experience, of course, with discounts and other things, but the entire buying experience, right? And then these e-commerce, online retailers, e-commerce sites like Amazon and Flipkart and Snapdeal came up, and you know, Paytm came along. They started offering a convenience which even the malls could not offer. That is, we are open 24/7. We can take your orders 24/7 at a time and place of your choosing. That's why they became very successful. Dependability. How reliable is the service? You know, if in Amazon, if they say that we'll deliver within one day, they will deliver. They should ensure that they deliver in one day. If most of the people feel they're not able to deliver on one day, then they will be under soup because customers will start rejecting it. Right? So you have, you know, when you're providing service that within two business days, we will solve your problem, then the company should keep a margin of some time so that to ensure that everyone is served within that period for which the promise has been made. So because the customers will see how dependable they are. Are they only talking about it or they are actually doing it? So how reliable the service is? Like in airlines, here's an example of airline given. Like how much, you know, they go on time, they arrive and depart on time. So Indian Airlines, Indian Railways is an example where, you know, the time, the dependability of the train service is questionable. So you're not sure about the arrival. Definitely departure is more or less at the same time, but arrival is questionable. It's always late, or, you know, most of the time it's late. So people tend to take airlines which are much more reliable. And of course, in airlines also, you have Indian Airlines and Air India, which probably may not have such strict penalties put up on their crew to ensure the departure and arrival performance. But in private airline, they have to do it because government is not supporting them. So the only way they can support is through customers who are satisfaction. And customers, when they are satisfied, they will fly more. Once they fly more, their planes will be full, and only then they will go into profitability. Otherwise, they will be in losses. Personalization. How much personalization I'm able to do for my service? Right? How much personalization I'm able to do for my service? Right? Is there a requirement in the first place? So, you must have, like in a restaurant, there is a need for personalization. You go to a restaurant for an experience. So he can make a dish according to your choice. He can take it. He can deliver to you 15 minutes. Although the dish takes 5 minutes to make, but you can ask him, give me 15 minutes late. Right? So he can add more spices. He can add less salt. He can make so many changes. So there personalization is required. In some services, personalization is not possible. Not like airline, you know, you can't have your own time. If they find that 50% of people, they are losing passengers because there's no time slot. There's a time slot which suits passengers, but they have not got, then they'll create a flight schedule which will suit the majority of passengers within that time slot. So when they design the time slots for their flights, they have already seen the pattern that most of the people fly in these time slots. So they will ensure that in each morning, afternoon, evening, in morning generally flights are full because most of the people tend to go in the morning or in the late evening. Afternoon there you can get seats easily, depending upon the sector in which you're flying, right? The reason is people tend to fly off early in the morning, and if they want, they can come back in the evening if it's in a day trip. So there, you know, customization cannot go beyond a certain time. But in hospitality industry, it's extremely customized. Even in hotel, you can customize even the type of, you know, I want my bed sheet to be changed twice. I want my laundry to be done this way. I want my shirts to be ironed. I want my shirts to be ironed and delivered within 2 hours. So they'll charge a special price for you, but they'll give it to you, you know. And so these are the various types of services which can be personalized. So that you have to see whether customization can be provided or not. And generally services are customized, but up to what level your company is ready to give. Price. Now, price is very important because price will differentiate between a quality. It's an extremely, it's a differentiator quality. Just by looking at the price, people think an expensive thing means it's a quality product. So that's the best differentiator of a quality. You go to, if you go to big bazaar, you have Big Bazaar, you have Vishal Mega Mart, you have Fashion Street people on the road selling clothes, a shirt, people selling on the road a shirt, you have Vishal Mega Mart selling shirt, you have Big Bazaar selling shirt, then you have Shopper Stop selling shirt. Right, in all these three, the prices of the shirts will be very different because they have to be kept differently. A Shopper Stop shirt cannot be priced at 100 rupees or 50 rupees because they know the type of customers who come over there, they will look upon, you know, they want a certain quality, and quality does not come cheap. And even if it is cheap for them, it will be priced expensively to ensure that the customers get a satisfaction of buying an expensive product from them and getting that ego fulfilled. Whereas even if it is an expensive product in Fashion Street, the price margin, the profit margin of a person who is selling on the roadside has to be kept minimum because he knows the people who come there to buy clothes from him are the people who do not have much cash at their disposal. So therefore, prices have to be kept minimum as possible. Quality is judged by both process of services delivery and output that comes out of the service. So you can see the quality when you buy a Shopper Stop, you know, you get your own, you maybe on the Fashion Street, you will get a simple polythene bag. In the Big Bazaar, you will get a polythene bag with a stamp on it. It's embossed, branded. If you go in the Shopper Stop, you'll get a cardboard type of box with your own handle. You can take it, you know, along with you. And very neatly packed and all these things, right? So the delivery, in the person selling on the street, he will only ask for cash. In the Shopper Stop and Big Bazaar, you can use cards. You can use Paytm. You can use credit card, debit card. You can use cash. So these are all the options given, right? That's the process of service delivery. Also, if you see the expensive stores, many of the expensive stores, how the you know, the stuff is kept at the roadside stall, at the roadside street, you know, how, when he's selling clothes, it's just piled up one on top of another. You have to literally dig your size. You have to see, whereas in all the other places, it is kept neatly and it is segregated as per the size, so you can just pick up what you want. And in very expensive stores, they do not keep more than 3 to 4 shirts on one top of another, like Shopper Stop, not more than 3 to 4 shirts on top of another, right? And they have individual lighting focusing on that to make it attractive. So that's also a process of delivery. Reputation, yes. Unlike a product, a poor service experience cannot be exchanged or returned for a different model. So a product can be exchanged, but for a poor service, what happens if you get a bad dish? Of course, that can be done. But what happens if you are, you know, you get a very bad service from Jio, Reliance Jio, 1 month, you have wasted a lot of money, right? And this quality of service, which you get in terms of data broadband, is not up to mark. They claim to be 10 Mbps, but you get only 1 or 2. Can you get that time? Can you get that? You may not get. They may give you an extension, but that time when you had the service, that time can never be returned. If you talk to a call center guy, he is rude to you, then that cannot be undone so easily. They may call you again and ask for apology, but then by that time, the things have already gone bad. So positive word of mouth is the most effective form of advertising. And this is what they do many of the times. Then safety. Right, in certain services like air travel and medicine, right, even for right in these all these places, the customer ensure wants to go to the best doctor to ensure that he's being treated fairly at a price he can pay and he gets the best service because his life depends upon him. You know, you cannot fly in an airline where the planes are not well maintained. You want to ensure you go in an airline which has the best fleet, newest planes flown by experienced pilots who can take care of any emergencies if they anytime have. right? Same as if you're going for a, let's take an example of safety and service. If you want to buy a rope for hanging your clothes, you can buy any, you'll buy the cheapest one. But if you want to buy a rope for hiking, if you want to go on a trekking or hiking on a mountain, then you will ensure you get the best quality rope, which is of the highest quality, and it will not put you in danger. It will not break. It can sustain your weight and your equipment's weight when required. Second is speed. How long? Next is speed. How long must I wait for service? Hello. Yeah. How long, Ravi Karan? Close your. Yeah. How long? How long? Hello, Ravi. Ravi, close your mic, please. Ravi, close your mic. Yeah, thanks. Okay. Speed. How long should I wait for the service? Is it going to last eternity? You know, sometimes the time is very important for in services to be delivered. Like, for example, you know, a doctor which needs to perform an emergency operation, then he should be there. So therefore, in the hospitals, you have the OPD, which operates only during certain times of the day. And then you have the emergencies, you know, department or emergency, you know, what do you call, department, where doctors are, where a doctor is available 24/7, and that caters only to emergency situations, right? And that is the place where the charges are also different than OPD. For an OPD, for the same thing, price, the charges are different. For the emergency, they are much more higher because you're getting the speed of delivery at your time and place of your choosing. Same as with fire or police and all. If they take so much time in responding, then you find it, you know, that services provided are not up to mark. Okay, so technology in services. So you have, like, you know, the technology, whenever the technology has come, ever since the technology has come into the picture, the performance of the services has improved tremendously. And most of many times with the help of technology, the services have become unassisted. It is not required for them to be assisted in any way. So, like, here is an example, you know, you can, in Western countries, you can fill up the, you know, petrol at the pump and then put up your card over there and then, you know, pay it on there without any help. Also, you know, you can book your own flights on internet. You can book your own rail tickets. You can go to yatra.com and make your own bookings of train. You can go to redbus.com and make your own tickets of buses, right? So all these examples. And even like buying online through Amazon is online. It's IT, information technology. Technology is helping me. So technology and service encounter. How the different types of, you know, service encounters which has happened with the technology. So how technology has shaped the service encounter. When we say service encounter, we mean by service encounter that how there is an interaction happening between customer and the server. Server means an employee on behalf of the company who is serving you. So advances in communication and information technology are having profound impact on ways customer interacts with the service providers. There are five modes of technology contribution. So technology has contributed to the service industry, to the service encounter in five ways, right? So this is the contribution of the technology. First, technology-free service encounter. Here, what happens is the customer and the server, both are in close proximity. They are next to each other. They are physically present to each other, right? And the service provider is providing a service provider is a human being who's providing the service. This is generally a traditional way of serving a customers, right? Like you have the hairdresser, saloon, doctor, generally, accountant who's coming to you and visiting you in your chartered accountant, right? Architect who's discussing with you, all these things. These type of services are called high touch services. We'll talk about it later in detail. What are high touch and low touch? These type of services are high touch services where technology does not have a much direct role, right? It does not play much direct load. So it's a technology-free service encounter. A doctor is checking your pulse. A nurse is taking your reading of on thermometer of your fever. An architect is showing you designs of your houses. He's discussing with you all these things. A hairdresser is cutting your hair through his scissor. A saloon guy is doing makeup for you. All these things. So this is technology-free service encounter. Second is technology-assisted service encounter. Here you are in close proximity. This customer and the server both are next to each other. They are in close proximity to each other. They are physically present to each other, face to face. But they are using some technology to assist them. So here, coming to the same example of doctor who was using his pulse, who was checking your pulse through hand, now he is using a stethoscope to check your heartbeat. Now eye doctor is using a special light, which then he asks you to open and he sees through that. You must have seen when you go to an ophthalmologist, an eye specialist, there's a machine which tells, which he sees on the other side and decides the number of your eyes. So he says how much he checks physically, then he uses that machine, and then machine shows you some picture, and according to that it decides. Shows you a picture. Then machines makes a reading. Then finally, what he'll do is he will use a different type of lens and keep in front of you and ask you to read that. So using these three procedures, and in one procedure, he has used the technology of that machine, whereby machine generates some certain slip. So he does not make a decision based on just one parameter. He uses three type of tools. He checks physically, he uses a machine, and thirdly, he uses the different lenses and asks you to read to decide which, so combination of all these three readings, he tells you this is your number, right? So he has used the technology to come to a conclusion. Another one is a dental surgeon. He'll look at your teeth physically, but at the same time, he asks you to sit on a chair, and he has this different tools through which he'll use and try to check, diagnose, and also use his surgical tools to remove any tartar or any, yellowness on your teeth using those tools. So that's the technology. So the technology is still serving the server. You don't have access to the technology. The technology is being used by the server to perform his job, right? So this is technology assisted service encounter. Next is technology facilitated service encounter. Here, both customer and service provider have to the same technology. In the previous one, who has the technology? Who has access to the technology? Only the server. Here, both customer and server, both are using the technology, right? In the previous one, only the server is using the technology, not the customer. So both are using. So here, someone, a financial planner, comes and he sits with you, shows you some chart. He goes on the website, shows you some graphs, makes some graphs, and he's at the same time showing you. So you are using the technology and he's also using the technology. Both are consulting the technology to give this thing on a personal computer to illustrate this thing. You can also ask him to put up a certain different type of readings in there and tell key if I put these readings, then what will happen to my savings and all these things. So you can also play around with that. So both have access to the same technology, and this technology facilitates service encounter. Next is technology mediated service encounter. Here, up till first, second, and third, the ones we discussed now, up till now, all the technology was there or not there, where up till all the three scenarios before the service encounter scenarios, the server and the customer both were in close proximity to each other. They were most of the time face to face each other in close physical proximity. But in this one, the customer and human service provider, they're not physically together. They're not physically together. So they use a technology to mediate. They are separated by time. They are separated by place. And they use a technology to get over that distance factor. So like, for example, you know, just dial services. In just dial services, what I'm doing, when I call up that number in just dial, right, she asked me what I'm looking at. I said, I want these doctors in Greater Noida. I want a dentist in Greater Noida. So she asked, okay, which place in Greater? She asked, I want a dentist in Delhi. She said, where in Delhi? I said, in Greater Noida. He said, okay, Greater Noida is in UP. Fine. Greater Noida, which area? I said, Knowledge Park. So I said, okay. Then she looks at Knowledge Park. So what she's doing, all this thing, I'm using a technology using a phone. She's using a technology also using a phone and answering me back. But at the same time, she's using another technology, which is in the form of a laptop or whatever is there. And she's looking into it and she's giving me answers through that. So we both have access to the technology and we are not close to each other, right? So this is through the phone call. So technology mediated service encounter. Then technology generated service encounter. Here human service provider is replaced. Here the server is not there. The human server is not required. Technology allows you to do things automatically without any human interface required. And so it's a sort of self-service. So bank ATMs, you do it on your own. Website-based information you want, you do it on your own. You go to flipkart.com, you can buy your things on your own, right? Everything happens. You choose the product what you want. You want a shirt. So you say shirt, men's shirt. Then you look at size, you look at the color, you look at the shirt, you select the color, size, everything. You select the number of items, one, you add the one. Then you add the, then it says, okay, you know, what is your delivery and shipping address? You type your delivery and shipping address. It goes to next page. Okay, how will you pay? Cash on delivery or credit card? You say cash on delivery. Fine. Then you say, are you sure? They ask you, are you sure? You say, yes. Click. You say, submit. Then immediately you receive an SMS or an email that, you know, we have accepted your order. Now your order is under consideration. After some time, you receive an SMS. Your product is shipped. Then you will receive an SMS that product is, you know, under transit. Then you will receive an SMS that courier will come to you today. Then probably the courier guy will also, or that day, then courier received today that you will be delivered today at this time. So much of things are automated. Human interface will only come if you have an issue with it. You can call them up that this is the problem. You can reschedule your order again. You can cancel your order again. You can cancel it also online. You can return the, if you have received it, you can return it online without using human interface. Human interface, human server will only come at the end when the guy comes to you with the delivery. Till that time, it's all automated. So technology generated service encounter is there. So this is a good example, e-commerce website, which I just told you, Flipkart and all these things. It's like this. Same thing is you can book and ticket on cleartrip.com or yatra.com. You can go online. Select the flight, select the time of the flight, make the payment and get the ticket delivered to you through PDF or on your email and on your SMS. No human interface is required over there. Everything has happened directly without any problem. Okay, so emergence of self-service. What has happened is with the use of technology, a lot of things have become. A lot of service providers are providing these things using technology. They're providing the service called self-service. So what has happened is they're able to, with the help of this technology, they're able to provide services which are offered 24/7, 365 days with computers running, no need of different shifts of people. It is cheaper. It is more productive. It is more customized. It is possible. Just imagine calling on, you know, Amazon guy and say, no, I want this color. I want that color. I want this shade. He'll look into it and come to you. But this is done. So it is much more accurate, much more customized. It is much more convenient, right? Any time of the day, you can book a flight ticket. Any time of the day, you can book a, you know, you can buy a thing you like. And it is very speedy. So cost saving and time and place are the advantages. So evolution of some services, evolution of self-service, how they have differed. In service industry banking, if you look at it, in self, you know, human contact, teller, you have the teller human contact. ATM came, machine assisted, electronic online, grocery, checkout clerk, self-checkout station. You know, you have some grocery self-checkout station where you can go and check out on your own. But then you have online, airlines, ticket agent, check-in kiosks. You go on the airport and there are kiosks over there where you can build, print your own boarding pass. You can check in, right? Now, electronically, you can print your boarding pass also. That's the next stage. Restaurants, waiting, there's a waiter there. Then vending machine, you have machines which give you all, you know, the products. Online order delivery, movie theater, ticket sale. There was a box office where you would go, you know, to buy the ticket. Now there's a like, you know, vending machines where you can take the tickets. Then electronic service, you can go online and pay for this movie by paying a certain amount, and the movie will be delivered to you for a certain time. You can see it. You can see it, and as soon as you finish seeing that, you won't be able to see that movie again. So it's only once. So you pay for view, which is very common these days on cable TV and Star Plus, and on you know, all these like, you know, Videocon, Airtel. They are offering the DTH service, the Sky TV, Scar. Tata Sky and all that possibility is there. Bookstore also, you have online shopping. Education, you have a teacher, traditionally teacher speaking, then computer tutorial which has come, you know, using a CDs. You can take a CD which is delivered to you and you can see it. Then again, the final which has come, machine electronic service, whereby, you know, you can listen to the lecture of a faculty who's based in Harvard University using online, and you can see that various courses are available. You can see that, and in fact, what is happening right now, we are doing it that only. It's an electronic service. I'm not physically present in front of you, but I'm delivering the same lecture through the internet. Okay, so automation services, right? Automation means replacing human manual activity by the machine. So now this professor, he's a very famous American professor of operations management. He has categorized different type of automation categories. One is fixed sequence. A machine does one task again and again as in a predetermined sequence, right? So automatic parking lot gate, what happens is you show your card, it will open. You show your card, it will open, you go inside. At the exit, you show your card, put your card next to that reader, it will open. That's the only thing it will learn. So it keeps on doing the same thing again. Then variable sequence. A machine, same as fixed sequence, robot, but they can be changed. The machine can behave differently based on the commands given. So ATM machine is like this. You know, it gives money, but then depending upon the command you give, how much money you want, in what denomination you want, and depending upon how much balance you have in your bank account, plus your daily withdrawal limit, all these things are considered, and then it gives you the final outcome in terms of the amount. If your amount you want is much more than the maximum withdrawal limit, then it will not give that. It will tell you that. If it is your maximum withdrawal limit is not done, but you have much less cash available to you, it will tell you that. So that ATM is a good example where it does different things depending upon information. They can be changed. Playback, like you go to the telephone answering machine, right? It's an example. So what you have is a machine that can produce operation from memory that were originally executed under human control. So in the telephone answering machine, you put up your, you know, your own voice saying that, you know, please leave your message XYZ. So anyone who, when you are not available, anyone who listens to your call and you are not able to answer it, then he listens to your message through that. But that initial message was given by you. Then numerical control, a machine that can perform task according to sequence as command by stored information that can be reprogrammed easily. So you find this in the amusement park, you know, you have the animated character, like, you know, they one character can do different things, but depending upon what you ask him to do, he'll do it. But that information is controlled. So depending upon how much money you put, it will take you, it will show you that. Then intelligent. An intelligent machine, what it does is it does not require human, input. It has its own sensors, and through its own sensors, it is able to detect the changes in the environment. And then according to the make of the machine, according to the what is expected to do, it will do it. So let's take an example of autopilot or a commercial airline. You know, all these airlines have these, all these planes these days have an autopilot function. When the plane takes off, the pilots, they switch on the autopilot, whereby the sensors in the plane, like speed and computer, the computer inside the aeroplane, it has various sensors on the outside, the speed, the air, the wind, the meteorological conditions, you know, how it looks and all these things. It can see all these changes, see all these things, and accordingly make variations in altitude and speed of the aircraft. So the pilot need not make changes on this all the time. The pilot will only come into the picture when there's an emergency or when the autopilot fails. So this is an intelligent system which can do it. So artificial intelligence these days, which many companies are working on, Google is working on, is talking about these things at the global, at the in the machine level, in the day-to-day system, like, you know, human assistance at home or in military and all these things. So autopilot is an example for intelligent thing. Then expert system, a computer program that uses an interface engine, decision rule and knowledge base to diagnose a problem, right? So you have like Google portal is an example. The way you type your query, it will deliver different results for different people depending upon, first of all, where you are from, because countries like China have banned certain words. It will not allow them to search that. If you ask a question in a particular way, it will give you a different answer and show you a different page slightly differently, right? Then totally automated system. Like electronic fund transfer, system of machine and computers that performs all the physical and intellectual tasks that are required to produce or deliver a service. So it's a totally other example for totally automated system is you go online, download antivirus, you pay online, everything is done automatically. Human behavior is not required. Okay, so we'll stop here. It's 3 o'clock. I think, should we stop here? Should we continue? Hello? So I think it's 3 o'clock. We need to stop here. My time is over. So accordingly, you'll be given assignment later on. And if you have any questions, you can ask me now. Regarding today's class. Anyone? All right. So Himanshu, Manas, Amil, Nazumuddin, Vasanti, Gudupeda, W. Singh. I believe, do you have any questions or we log off for today? Fine. Then okay, since you have no questions, I believe you already have my PPTs. You can go through it, right? So thanks, Gudepa, for telling me you don't have any question. So you know, we can, if you have any question later on, you can always contact me. My email will be given by the organizer, Ashish. So thank you, and thanks a lot, and we'll see you next week, and we'll probably give you an assignment to be done by next week. Thanks a lot. Thank you. Bye bye.